Hi there, everybody, and welcome to Talking True, where I speak to mystics, near-death experiencers, healers, and people who are undergoing radical and subtle awakenings too. Today, my guest is Carla Herschel. She is a healer, and she is also the host of a podcast, which is titled Cosmic Batter. Which sounds like a lot of fun, and I'd love to hear more about that. So, and today we're going to dive into the meaty topic of surrendering to the flow of Kundalini. So, Carla, welcome. I'm so happy you're here joining me today.
Yes, thank you for having me. I'm so excited.
So, you know, I love to hear a good story, and I'm sure you have a good story with respect to the awakening of the Kundalini. Do you want to share what that looked like for you?
Yes, it's been wild. It's fascinating to me because I had my sort of major Kundalini awakening, sort of also known as the spinal sweep, in January of this year, so like quite recent, where I had the energy come up out of my crown chakra, and I'll go into that in a moment. But I feel like my first sort of awakening was in 2021. And it's funny because I didn't even realize it was significant. So I had my spiritual awakening or dark night of the soul in 2021. I had moved from working all the time and knowing that something was wrong to taking a leap of faith and moving into mindset coaching at the time. And I let go of my old business, all my old clients, all my old friends as well. It was very painful. But I knew my soul was calling me to something better. Like, I even had to move back home with my parents and all sorts of things. So it was in 2021, and I woke up at 4 a.m. and I was already practiced in the dream state, but I woke up and I thought, okay, 4 a.m. it's a little bit too early to get out of bed. And then this beam of light just came out of the ether, like out of the roof, and the beam of light connected to me, and I knew it was light energy and it was pure and it was my guides or God. The beam of light connected to me, and then I heard it power up like a machine that you turn on. It was like, and it, like, I felt the light energy come into me and my body vibrating, and it felt like I was gonna vibrate out of the bed. And I just knew, this is safe, just relax and like let it happen. And then it was over. And I literally wrote it down on my phone straight away. I'm like, this just happened. I am awake. I'm wide awake. I saw it, heard it, felt it, like saw it with my physical eyes, which just blew me away. And that morning, like, I told my parents, I was like, look at what happened last night, a beam of light. And my parents are not so attuned to this stuff. So they were like, oh, that's nice.
Yes.
So you just didn't think that much of it. But after that, you know, I look back now and sort of have always seen things in the spirit realm, but I always brushed it off when I was younger. And after that moment, I really started to see things and have visions and pick up on other people's energies. And like, I would see entities for the first time, just like balls of energy or sort of shadows of figures like passing through. And it was all just kind of fun and games to me. I was like, oh, this is nice. Like, how fun. And like, I always knew that there was more. So then my journey progressed from mindset coaching to healing work, and it got more spiritual, and I did trauma-informed and NLP and learned more about helping people. So that work like deepened, and my practice of meditation and yoga just naturally sort of evolved. And then, yeah, the big most recent awakening. So there was a buildup in December of, so 2023, where I had been working really hard, and my spirit team was like, hey, you need to rest. And I realized I had overworked. I had created stuff that didn't fully align with me. So I thought, okay, I'm not interested in running that workshop. I'll let that go. I'll take a break. I'll enjoy my holidays. And my spirit team kept telling me to rest. And one day I like went for a run, and I thought, oh, maybe I could do this thing in my business, like as I'm running. And as soon as I thought about my business, I tripped over, and my spirit team was like, we said to rest. I was like, oh, okay. So no more exercise, just for a moment. And then I felt this energy building in my body all through January. And it felt like anxiety, honestly, because I didn't know what was happening. And I thought my nervous system felt like it was under a lot of pressure. And I thought, this is really bizarre because I'm normally fit, healthy, and well, and look after my mental health and all these things. So I felt the pressure building and I just thought it was stress. And then I started to get these really intense downloads about the universe. And at the time, I had been working as a psychic for about 6 months. Like, my spirit team had said, it's time to own this and use your psychic abilities as well as your healing work. So I was already working as a psychic, but then the downloads I was getting were just next level. Like, I understood the oneness of everything and I could feel it. And I actually felt like Carla, my identity, almost being in front of me and my hands and stuff being out in front of me and me being the universe, actually everything. And it was really beautiful. It's beautiful to talk about now, but at the time I was like, what the fuck is going on? Like, what is going on? And I didn't really tell anyone because I thought, am I going crazy? Like, it was bizarre. But I just focused on staying grounded and I looked after myself. I said, okay, it will pass, whatever is happening. And the energy continued to build. And then one morning, I felt a little bit more grounded. And I said, yeah, to my spirit team, I said, can I have a coffee? Now that I'm grounded today, can I have a coffee? And they said, no. And I was like, well, I have free will, so I'm going to have a coffee. Thanks. And so I had a coffee. And then it began, like, then the full awakening began. Like, my back started to cramp and I did feel a lot of fear. I actually said to my friend, I don't know what's going on. I can feel my body being pushed and squeezed. Like, I do not know what's going on. And fortunately, my friend said, this is some kind of death. Like, let it happen. Just surrender, whatever it is. Like, it will be okay. So then I lay down on my bed, like, feeling this fear and this overwhelm, what's happening to me. And I said, okay, divine, take me where we need to go. Like, I trust you. And as soon as I said that, I had my eyes closed. All of my ancestors came in and surrounded me and they were like blue beings. They had, you know, the outline of a person, but it wasn't a human form. My soul was kind of above my physical body. And they ripped my soul apart and re-put it together. So psychic surgery. Fortunately, I had heard of psychic surgery before, so I knew this is okay. And I knew they were giving me all sorts of spiritual upgrades. So that happened. And I was like, okay, that was crazy. I was sort of in shock. Anyway, and then at the time I was away from home. So I packed my things. I was like, I'm going to go home now because that was intense. And I came home and then the next day I woke up feeling fine. I thought that was an amazing experience. And my mom and I started to drive to the beach. We were like, we'll go to the ocean for a swim. And I was driving and then it started to happen again, like this really intense energy. And it felt like being on psychedelics, like things didn't look normal. Cars looked fake, like buildings looked fake. And I was driving, so I immediately pulled over because there was that, because the energy was so heightened, it did feel like anxiety again. It was uncomfortable. So I pulled over and I said to mom, I feel really stressed. I'm going to need you to take me home. I need you to drive. And my mom's like, oh, okay. So she drove me home and I just surrendered again. So I lay down on my bed and I did cry and I could tell now all this fear was being taken out of me. And I had to sort of face that fear to be able to receive, you know, the next level of confidence and strength and things like that. So I had fear and anxiety and doubt all come out of me and I could feel it coming out of my physical body. I was like making noise as well, letting it come out. So it would have looked very bizarre. But I said again, like, divine, take me where we need to go. And it was so special at this time because I knew I have to go through this on my own, in the sense I have to surrender to this and nobody can talk me out of this moment. Like, I am in ceremony, even though I'm completely sober on a random Sunday, like, haven't touched psychedelics, for example, in years. So, but this, it just I couldn't believe that it was happening in a normal life. But I thought, this is truly being self-led, and I can hold myself. I can get through this. Like, I can receive this. And then I heard a bird outside and I knew God was with me. And it might sound corny, but it was such, I just knew I was held. And then I also started to get these waves of love and gratitude, because I thought, you know what, after this, I can get a hug from my mom. After this, I can tell my friends, and like, I can go through this crazy experience and it's going to be okay. Like, I am okay. So the fear and stuff came out of me, and then I could see light everywhere. Like, the intensity of my visuals had been building for like 10 to 15 days, and now at this point with the full surrender, everything was light. Like, I couldn't look anywhere, and I would close my eyes and everything would be light as well. So it was just constant. And there were other feelings, like, you know, because this energy was coming up out of me, I actually felt my crown chakra open, and like, it was like an energetic vortex. And I now understand, if it's the, is it a lily flower that's often portrayed?
The lotus flower.
That's it.
Yes. Yeah.
Thank you. I felt like my energy around my head, like, open up like petals. It was like, mm-hmm. And it wasn't painful, but it was an intense, bizarre feeling, like opening a can opener or something. So I felt my energy open. I knew God was with me. I felt bliss and love. And then I had more visuals, and I saw a crow came and opened my third eye. And then the crow and I flew together for a while, which was very magical. And then the crow offered me a worm. And this was funny, because at the time I was like, ew, worms, no thanks. And then I had visuals of the worm is sacred, and we need it to transform from death to life, and it creates life, and everything that it does matters, and it, like, it might be small, but it has such a big role to play in nourishing the earth. And I just saw, oh, this is a gift, and it's wisdom, and it's safe. So I said, okay, I accept the gift, thank you, divine. And I think that was the majority of like what happened. And then after that, I had, you know, an intense integration period where the energy was so high, and I had to learn how to hold that. So, and this is where it was fascinating, because I found out what Kundalini was after. I hadn't heard of a Kundalini awakening, because I still was questioning, like, am I sane? Because all my psychic experiences before were fun and playful, and this was every end of the spectrum. I found out what Kundalini was, and I was surprised to see so much, you know, fear mongering about, like, oh, be careful of Kundalini, it's really dangerous. And I understood that, because it had been so scary. And I did think sometimes, am I losing my mind? But I learned very quickly that Kundalini is just energy. So if you're hanging out in the negative space, you're going to go there and you're going to experience that, which is life anyway. It's just amplified. And then when I'm in gratitude and appreciation and bliss, that gets amplified. And I also know, during the awakening, I had to purge those feelings out. It wasn't that I was in a bad place. It was actually like the greatest gift to feel that fear and acknowledge it and release it from my body. But then, yeah, it was integrating it, knowing, no, I actually am grounded. This is a gift. This is a part of my evolution. This is to be celebrated. And then I guess my discernment became so much more attuned, because I listened to some teachers talk about Kundalini, and I thought, I resonate with this or that. And then they'd say something that I found is actually really disempowering. Like, they might say, you know, be careful of entities. And entities are real, like, I've seen them. But as soon as you start to say, oh, be careful, you're actually playing in the realm of fear. And I knew very quickly, if I step into the fear, I feel the fear. So I then had to come back to, like, oh, you don't have to worry about it at all. Like, and as soon as you don't worry about it, it doesn't exist. And it all comes from within, and I am enough. So I changed the teachers that I was working with. And since then, I've still been doing major energetic like cleanses, you know, reassessing who I follow on social media and who I'm connected to and where I'm getting my advice from, and more time for myself, a lot more time meditating. And I've now been receiving like a much stronger knowing in my meditations. And I actually have what I would call like a channeling guide, although I don't even know if channeling is the right word anymore, but a guide that's a dragon, which is funny because I got a dragon tattoo in 2019 and I didn't realize like they are very significant to me. But the dragon came in one of my meditations and showed me several past lives. And he said, this is why you're carrying so much fear. Like you've been killed for certain things in the past. And I already knew that. I do a lot of past life work, but my dragon guide was like, you know, you have been healing from these and you've processed that, which is amazing. But so you've viewed a lot of fear. And he showed me a couple of positive lifetimes that I've had, like one lifetime where I was Chinese and I was working with martial arts and then spreading like awareness around the physical mind-body connection, and another lifetime where I was American Indian, Native Indian, and the lifetime of like the tribe. And yeah, it was just so beautiful. And then being like, I'm safe, I'm supported, and I've done this before. And yeah, I mean, there's so much more I could share, but that's the in a nutshell.
Yeah, that's quite intense. Yeah, I'd love to unpack what happened with you after these significant events in terms of your sort of physical expression, or your physicality in terms of, you know, foods or diet, or, you know, what happened? Did you go through a purging, or what happened there?
Yeah, fortunately, I did not have any physical purging. Like I wasn't sick or anything like that, which is actually surprising because I feel like I went to some very dark places. It was a different type of purge. But physically, I don't view my body the same as I did before. I've always loved my body, but I come from a fitness background. I used to be a personal trainer. I used to be a dancer as well. So I've always really been aware of exercise and staying strong and actively staying strong. And then, you know, in January, when my spirit team was like, slow down and like, stop exercising, because, you know, I ran and I fell over. And another time in that period, I went to jump onto a bar and hang from the bar. And I literally jumped up and my hands just didn't grab the bar and I fell on my ass. I was so embarrassed. I'm like, I hope no one saw that. And my spirit team again was like, we said rest. I was like, hey, no exercise at all. Well, I've been doing yoga and walking, but no trying to be strong. Mm-hmm. And so then after my awakening, I've just been like, I am strong. And the movement that I do day to day, I still do yoga, but the movement I do day to day is enough. I play all the time. I play and I dance. I surf, like I do fun things, and that's enough. And now play is a really big drive for me. Like I see the value of joy. And so to set aside time to do a workout, at least in this moment, that doesn't bring me joy. And so I don't have to do that, which just for me, I find that really surprising. And then in terms of food, I actually started buying like organic, and I wasn't doing that before because the universe has stretched me with money. And I was investing actually into my business and my education, but I stopped working with that mentor after. And I sort of realized, you know, this actually is more important to me in this moment. Obviously, there was more reasons behind that decision, but that organic is really important. And it doesn't matter if I don't have that much money, like, because the universe has put me into this position for a reason, but therefore I have money for food, of course. And whatever I spend on food, you know, the universe will provide, it will be okay. But I still eat meat at this moment.
Yeah, which is
I feel like,
okay. You know,
yeah.
it's really good because I think, you know, a lot of people can either prior to or after a Kundalini awakening can become a bit obsessed about what they should or shouldn't be eating. And I always remember His Holiness the Dalai Lama speaking about this, and he said he eats meat, occasionally eats meat. And because, you know, it's the Tibetan way, or it was, I don't know whether it still is. And some people do need to eat, you know, animal protein. I've been a vegetarian on and off since I was 14, but certainly after the Kundalini awakening, the interest in meat just really fell away. Although now I do eat fish, but it does sometimes impact people's choices in terms of what feels like the right food for them. And it, the thing is with a Kundalini is that it is supremely intelligent, and it will guide and direct you and tell you what your body needs to be able to sort of be well nourished and to be able to do the practices like meditation and yoga and whatever else it is that you're led to do. Yeah, I was just interested if you had, you know, suddenly become a vegan or something like that. It's not always the case, that's for sure, you know.
Well, I have had eczema and it's healing so much now over the last few years, but I did try being vegetarian and vegan for 2 years, around like 2016, I think. And I enjoyed being vegetarian and vegan. I still like enjoyed the food, but I was not well. Like I was tired all the time, I was sick all the time, and variety of reasons for that. But as I came out of that, as soon as I ate meat again, I felt so much better. And then a few years ago, I actually tried carnivore, eating only meat. And again, there was more reasons behind that. I was at a really, really stressful point in my life. It was actually just before my spiritual awakening in 2021, where I was living with old friends. It wasn't working anymore. There was so much behavior that I didn't agree with and I didn't judge it, but it actually was having a massive impact on me. So I went carnivore and I look back now and I think that was just me trying to control my life. But my body actually responded well to that. So I'm not carnivore anymore. It's not sustainable for me. But yeah, at this point, I just know, yeah, my body does better with meat. But you know, I'm open to wherever Kundalini guides me.
And then look, I tell you what I do love to ask about is the creative expression, because oftentimes when there's a Kundalini awakening, there's this kind of sudden draw to start something creative, to learn how to draw or to paint or to write a book or to do something. And that was certainly the case in my story. Was that the same for you?
Yeah, it's funny that you say that because I've literally been drawing, and it's funny because in my psychic readings and I've changed them now to intuitive readings so that people are more empowered. But in my psychic readings, people would often sit down with me and I would give them, you know, advice and guidance and just what was coming through. And most people, I said, you need more creativity. I can sense in your life that it's lacking. You're really focused on work. And that's kind of it, you know, start something artistic. It's funny that I'm like telling all these people to do that or, you know, giving that advice. And then after my Kundalini awakening, I was like, what am I doing? Why am I not, you know, drawing and things? And I found something that's really helpful, especially after Kundalini, is I can't spend as much time in a form of, you know, avoidance or distraction. So if I scroll on social media, I just cannot do it like I did before. And I can watch TV, but you know, it's just rare, or it'll be one episode. I'm like, all right, I'm done. So I have time. I have so much time now. So I have time to draw. So yeah, I started drawing. I bought a paint kit just to start with something basic because I'm not haven't viewed myself as an artist previously, but you know, I am. But I bought a paint kit and I realized it was a paint by numbers. I just thought this will be fun. And I've been doing that. And then I'm like, what's the point of doing this? I should just paint. So I'm going to get a blank canvas and just allow whatever, you know, to flow out of me. Yeah. And I think I've realized as well, just the creativity, just in life in general, especially. So I felt I was already creative in my work and the way that I show up. If I make content or my podcast, it's all art at the end of the day. But now I feel, I guess, safe allowing the process to be, well, just to be in the unknown. So before I'd have my business and I'd still have a rough plan. And now there's no plan. Just whatever feels right. And whatever feels right and good and divine, that's the highest timeline. Don't need, like, you know, I have things in place so I know where I'm going and I'm supported, but there's no plan. And I think the creativity that runs behind that is, yeah, I just think that's creative.
Yes, which is fantastic. I mean, one of the, I've taught quite a few intuitive painting workshops and you're both online and in person. And I've worked with many adults who want to start being creative midlife or late in life. And I'm just kind of sharing this for you or for viewers who might be interested in having a go at something intuitive where you either get a large piece of heavy watercolor paper or a canvas you can use as well, and then just lay some colors down. You can squeeze the paint directly onto the canvas, and, you know, feel into the colors that you feel like using, and then just squeeze a few blobs, and then either use an old credit card or a palette knife or something to move it around, or move your hands with it, and just keep going and you know, put the colors together and maybe scratch out or do whatever, use your nail to take some of it out, and anyway, and let it just kind of either blend or stay as separate colors and all of those things, and then let it dry, and then see what forms you can see on the surface, because there's always something in there that you can identify. You know, you turn your canvas around and oftentimes it's absolutely incredible the way the paint dries will form either a face or a flower or something organic.
Wow.
And something that you can see. And then you can go in and start kind of adding more detail and bringing that to life. And you can either darken the background to bring that forward or, you know, add other elements as well. But that's a really fun way to play with paint and color and line and form in an intuitive way without having to be, you know, like feel like you have to take classes and learn how to draw something correctly to be able to do it.
Yeah, I love that. I'll have to come for a session.
Yeah, it's yeah. Really fun.
And I've found the same joy principle applies. Like if it feels good, it will be good. And if it doesn't, like it won't. And I thought this was so funny recently. I was like, I'll draw something. And I thought, oh, I'll draw this candle. Okay, that's fine. And then I thought, oh, I'll draw this bird. And okay, that's fun. And then I was looking around like, what else should I draw? And I thought, well, I guess I could draw my headphones. And I didn't really feel inspired by that, but I was like, I'll give it a go. And it was absolutely not good because I didn't want to do it. My candle was actually really good. The bird was amazing. And then when I tried to draw something I didn't want to draw, just looked like drawn with my opposite hand. And I thought, well, there's a lesson in, you know, listening to what feels right.
Yes. And just, yeah, and having fun with it, you know, really just playing. And also maybe just doodling. Sometimes that's always a good way to get started on a scrap of paper and just doodle either with your dominant or non-dominant hand, see what comes out of it. And then you can move those onto a, you know, as canvas or a board or paper surface. And just as a starting point, you know, it's a bit like stream of consciousness writing where you ask a question or you just, you know, start writing what's coming up and coming out of you. It's the intuitive painting, because the whole point is that you're kind of moving away from the critical mind and you're going into the heart and listening to the heart and relaxing also the subconscious as well, and just having fun with that. It's really good. Yeah.
With that, I definitely need to get into writing, and like I want to write a book, and that's something I always knew I would do. But so I started reading Julie's book about her awakening journey, and I've been like, oh my god, this is amazing. And it's just your story, or not just like, but it's just your story. And I have kept all of my journals, and I always had a thing in the back of my head like, I need to keep these journals for the day a movie's made about me. Like, yes. And I thought it was funny, but I don't know. I just always felt that I should keep them. And after I almost finished your book, I was like, well, I think this is my invitation. I see how possible and easy it can be. And I have the materials, obviously, I remember. Like, I just, you know, now is the time.
Yes, yes. And look, you know, I don't just say naive, but I didn't know anything about writing a book in terms of how to get it published. Mm-hmm. But I just got this, I think I told you I had a lucid dream, and this, you know, master yogi came in the dream and said, when are you writing the book? And I said, what am I supposed to write about? And she just kind of gave me one of those looks as if to say, oh, come on, don't be so dumb, you know? And anyway, I woke up out of the dream and I said, okay, I'll write a book, but I'm not going to write anything if it comes from ego, because I'm just not interested. And then I left it alone. And then 2 or 3 weeks went by and I was doing a house sit and for looking after a friend's dog and their house while they were traveling. And I was sitting on the balcony drinking coffee early one morning and I started to hear the kind of the opening of the book, and the book was kind of being, it felt like it was being downloaded. I started writing it, and I really didn't have a clue about anything to do with where to go with it, you know. And then lo and behold, as these things always do, I received an email from a friend who said, you know, I have this feeling that you should be writing a book, and I just wrote to tell you that there's a platform called Smashwords, and it's free, and you can publish your book on there. And, you know, so it's, wow. You know how it goes. It's like one thing after the other, and you're given guidance and support. And that's where I started. And then, you know, moved some of the later books over to Amazon as well, and found somebody to do the formatting, because I did not want to learn how to do all the formatting. I wasn't interested. And so yeah. I just, you know, I paid people to help with the parts that I didn't care for. And the rest is really straightforward. You know, once you've got your file and you've got the cover design and all of that, it's fairly easy, actually. But anyway, I'm just sharing that, you know, Smashwords, Amazon, all of those. And there's probably a lot more platforms now. But
helpful.
It's very helpful.
Yeah, it just goes to show, like, when you trust, it will be easy. Like, when it's the right time, it will be easy. Like, we were talking about that before we started recording, how, yeah, when we are in that place of trust, if it's meant to happen, it will flow. And it's been interesting, especially after my major, like, Kundalini awakening, accepting that flow, accepting that surrender, you know, surrendering to the experience is now like, okay, surrendering to the ongoing experience of life. And I noticed how much control I had in my business and my life before. Before, if someone was going to do healing work with me, I was pretty much always aiming for what's considered like high ticket. So they'd pay a lot more to be in my energy for a 3-month block or a 6-month block, which is a big investment and a lot of time. Mm-hmm. And then I realized, you know, it was a really good service. Like, I'm very good at what I do, but that a part of me was doing that to feel safe, to feel that I was supported, to feel that I had consistent income, consistent clients, whatever. And like, controlling a little bit. And then for me, I was like, okay, if I were to release control, what would I want? And I thought, you know what? I want to be busy. I want to be busier with more people, drop my prices, once-off healing sessions, one-on-one sessions, like a totally different energy from what I was in before. And it's funny because now I know if it feels right, it will be easy. It doesn't feel like I'm jumping off a ledge, like changing my business is massive thing. It's just like, no, this is what's right. And therefore, you know, it will come. And so yes. I feel, yeah, with the book also, reading yours, and I felt that permission, like, you know, I've always wanted to write a book. It probably is going to start soon. Be like, oh, cool. Okay. Easy. It's not a problem. It will just come.
Yes. Yes. And that's the beauty of it, right? When you're in the flow of the Kundalini and you surrender to that, then it takes you to places that you would never have imagined. I mean, I've shared this story quite a few times, but it's worth it, you know, in the context of what we're speaking about now, it's worth sharing again. But, you know, I had no desire or drive to be an author or to write articles for Mind, Body, Spirit magazines or any of that. That wasn't my part of my sort of goal plan. Some years ago, I think it was before I got the prompt or the push to write the first book, I was on a train with my husband. We were traveling from London up to Nottingham, which is a like 2.5 hour journey. I didn't have anything to read. And then I remembered that I had a little magazine that I picked up from a Mind, Body, Spirit bookstore. It was a free, you know, those free little magazines. And so I took that out of my bag, started to read it. And there was an article by Barbara Brennan, who's a well-known American healer. And she was speaking about the importance of utilizing your creative energy. And if you don't utilize your creative energy, then it kind of becomes repressed and it can manifest as depression. Anyway, I was, I think maybe a paragraph in or a paragraph and a half in. And then as I'm reading, I got this message, you can do this. You can write articles that inspire other people. So I just immediately turned to my husband and said, do you have anything to write on? He said, no, I've got a napkin. I said, have you got a pen or pencil? He said, I've got a pencil. And I could hear it again. It was being downloaded. And I started writing down this article. I'll never forget the title of it. It was called Coming into True Alignment. And anyway, when we got to Nottingham, I went to the library, local library there. I sat down at the computer, typed it all up. I didn't even have any devices with me when I was traveling. But anyway, so I typed it all up, sent it to the editor of the magazine that I was reading. And I knew when I hit send that it would be accepted, and it was.
Wow. And then
I was invited to be the feature writer for the magazine. And then from that point on, it really empowered me because I thought, well, this is easy. So I started then kind of cold calling editors for magazines like Light of Consciousness magazine, Kindred Spirit, which is well known in the UK, Awareness magazine, which is known in California. You know, anyway, a lot of them.
Amazing.
And honestly, I'm not exaggerating. I would say 98% of them were accepted. Just about every single time I sent the article in, it would be published. I even wrote for the Tiny Buddha platform. You know, I don't know if you're familiar with that, but that's well known in the US and other platforms. And it just blew up. And I remember my friend, who's a former a journalist for the New York Times. She said to me, it's not supposed to be this easy, you know, and she was laughing about that. And I just said, well, it is when the Kundalini starts to flow and you go with it and you surrender to it. It just is absolutely incredible what happens. You know, that is obviously as long as you get out of the thinking mind and the doubting mind and trying to analyze and figure it out and control it and all of that.
Yeah.
If you can just, as you said, surrender and go with the flow of it, miracles happen.
Yeah. Yeah, it's really incredible hearing that. And, you know, Kundalini, like, from my perspective at this moment, you know, we all have it. Like, it is life force energy, and there are various stages of awakening, which is wonderful. But it is, I feel, intuition. Like, we all have the basic gut feeling. Everybody has that. And it just amplifies the more that you listen to it. Like, the awakening experience is just a process of trusting that. And yeah, I've had to look at my own controlling behaviors and my own human mind, especially after like the more recent experience, you know, and I have a habit of writing to-do lists and being like, well, if I do this, then I'll do this, 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 and that, and then adding them to this, you know, ongoing to-do list that I have. And so often after Kundalini, I have to take a step back and be like, hey, what actually is good in the priority and what's actually a distraction? Like, for example, if I make a podcast, I'll always pull out one video from it to put on my socials. And before, I'd make a couple of other ones. And then for me, I had to be like, you know, it actually doesn't feel good to post multiple. Like, and I just don't make content for the sake of content. Pick the one that feels good. That's enough. And like, let it be easy for myself as well.
Yes.
But also when you're talking about like, you know, publishing and things and that it was easy, like I've had a lot of visions about my future. Especially during the awakening, I saw a lot of what I'll be doing. But even before, I had a vibe of the work that I'll be doing. And I see myself speaking on stages somehow, some way. And the mentors that I was working with before, because I've had several types of mentors, they recommended that I go out and find like places to speak at or events where you can, I think, like pay to speak or ask to speak and hold something. And I sat with that. This was a year ago. I sat with that and I was like, something about this doesn't, it doesn't feel right. It doesn't feel organic. And the word manufactured crossed my mind. And I thought that was interesting because as humans and like in society, we so often get told if this is the goal, backtrack, you know, do this, then that, then that. And that's how we get into, you know, ticking things off a list or thinking that things happen in a certain order. And we also delay things because we think we have to do X, Y, Z to get to wherever we want. Like we apply all these conditions to it. Anyway, the word manufactured crossed my mind and so this was, yeah, 2023. And then I had visions of like, I'll be invited on. I don't need to go out and ask or push, like just do my thing and it will happen. And it's interesting because now my podcast, Cosmic Batter, which is my newer one, my old podcast was a bit more rigid or structured and, you know, it came from the mind. You could say that. And Cosmic Batter, I just do it for fun. It's so organic. It's very authentic. And then, you know, this opportunity has popped up.
Yes.
Just been invited. And it has been easy and it feels natural. And yeah, and it makes me excited. The more you trust, like it will come or I'll be told when to take action. It's like, then it's all easy.
Yes. Yes. You know, and it's understanding how to sort of work with the energy of that too, the energy of the awakened Kundalini. By, you know, oftentimes what I'll do is I'll create an intention and then I'll float that intention out into the universe.
Mm.
For example, you know, I would love to be, I'm here if anybody is looking to invite me onto their show, or however you would phrase that, right?
Mm-hmm.
I would love to speak about, and you can kind of articulate what you want to speak about. So you're creating this kind of energetic imprint and invitation to go out into the universe. And to let the universe know that you're available to be able to speak on certain subjects. And I think that's a much more effective way rather than trying to drive, you know, outcomes or, as you said, manufacture something and keep driving it hard and also wearing yourself out doing it too, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I find this, I've been thinking about this a lot recently where there's sort of a flaw in mainstream manifestation because manifestation is real in, like you just said, you set an intention and it can come to you or it's goal setting or like it's real. But I feel the mainstream approach often says, so if you want something, embody that and do what you would do to be that and take this action and figure out the things. And I noticed myself in that mindset just burning out. And yes. I was like, okay, especially in my fitness business years ago, I'd be like, okay, if I want to make more money, I have to do more. And then it just got insane, like how much I was working, just trying to get money and like trying to hold on to it. And now the way that things flow for me with just letting it happen and like, okay, this feels good. And I am it.
Yes.
I am it. I don't have to pretend or try to embody someone else. Of course, I am embodying trust and faith and taking action, but it's not outside of me. It is me. And yes. Then it just comes.
Yes. Yes. Yeah. And you are operating from expressing as and living as abundance itself, which is then able to gift other people in a really generous and limitless way. So yes. On that note, I'm just realizing the time. It's amazing how time goes. Before we kind of wrap up and say goodbye to everybody, do you want to just share how people can find you, what you have on offer, and where they can reach you?
Yes. So Instagram is my main platform, but I'm on Instagram, TikTok, and YouTube. It's just Carla Herschel. My podcast is Cosmic Batter, but it's still under Carla Herschel on YouTube. And if you're interested in working with me, Instagram, go to the link in my bio, and I offer healing sessions and intuitive readings. But they have free offers as well. So I have a free meditation there at the moment, the Earth meditation. There's a whole meditation series where we connect to different elements, and each one offers like a different type of healing, which was they were beautiful. I highly recommend them. And I also have a free soul activation, and we go through a few past lives and clear things and take your power back and kind of upgrade your DNA and your cells and speak with your guides. And the soul activation is just really beautiful. Like, I would love to share that. So that's free as well.
Wow. That's great. So I can have all that information in the show notes, especially with the free, things that you're offering. It'd be really great.
Beautiful. Thank you so much. Yeah.
Well, Carla, thank you so much for joining me today. This has been a really great conversation. I loved every minute, and I know I could speak for hours about Kundalini.
Yeah.
The effects of it and the absolute magic of it and all of that. So thank you so much.
Yeah, thank you for having me. Beautiful to spread that trust and faith, and like, it's all joy, it's all love, all the healing work, living as a human being, it's all divine. So I love to share that.
Fantastic. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
And thank you everybody for joining us today. As always, if you enjoy and value this content, then please let other people know. And if you haven't already subscribed, you know what to do. So thanks so much again for joining us. It's been really great having you here. And if you want to leave comments or ask questions, feel free to do so, and we'll get back to you as soon as we can. So, sending you much love. Be well, take it easy, and bye for now. Bye.
Bye.